Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, David. Call the meeting to order. Welcome to everyone. This is the first November meeting, Alamance County Board of Commissioners, November 4th, 2013. Our first order of business is to welcome folks for public comments. We have three individuals that would like to address the board this morning. I'd like to begin with Mr. Rick Bowman. Rick, please come forward. Welcome.
Thank you. Good morning. Appreciate y'all having time to visit with me this morning and listen to me. I had planned on speaking at the last meeting and didn't understand the procedure, so I signed up this time. My name's Rick Bowman. I live at Altamaha Hall Racetrack Road, directly across from a speedway. And at the last meeting, y'all heard a complaint that we had related to noise, particularly for an event on October the 13th on a Sunday. And I appreciate your quick response to that. Jason Martin and Planning got in touch with Brad Allen per your instructions and met with him. He also met with the fire marshal. His name escapes me right now.
David Leonard.
And they expressed our concerns. We had a petition signed by 62 residents in the neighborhood, and they were all concerned with it as well. It was a window rattling event, as we described last time. So Jason met with Mr. Allen. Mr. Allen agreed, called me, and we agreed to have a meeting Monday this last week ago. And the meeting was a little testy at times, but we worked it out and came to a verbal agreement. And basically he agreed that he would never have an event like that again. And that he also, we had some other concerns that came up when I was getting the petition signed from some of the residents. They also agreed that they would not have anything on a Sunday out there unless it was a makeup race, which he can't help that. I understand that. And as a resident there, our community knows that there's going to be racing events and there's noise associated with that, and we expect it. It's the non-racing events we were concerned about. He's also agreed to reduce the number of times that the racers are out there practicing. They got to the point they were out there at all hours of the day, even into 7:30, 8 o'clock at night. He's going to try to do better with that. And he also agreed that if anybody in our community had a problem, we could come to him and talk to him about it, and hopefully we could come to a resolution before it comes back to the commissioners. But my main focus in being here today was to tell you thank you for your quick response to it. Thank Jason Martin, and I thank Brad Allen for working with us. Verbal agreement's only as good as the actions that are associated with it, as the old saying goes. So we'll see how it goes from here. Hopefully you won't hear from me again or on anything related to this event. Thank you for your time.
Rick, thank you. And thanks to Jason and Dave, everybody, for getting together. Rick, come back anytime. Our next speaker is Ms. Ann Vaughn, who'd like to talk about history. Ms. Vaughn, good morning.
Good morning, Commissioners. Bill, glad to see you back.
Thank you.
And your health is improving. And notice that today is, you should be wearing red if you support teachers in education, and I just want to give a special thank you to Tim Sutton, who is wearing his red shirt.
It's the only one I had clean, so that didn't have anything to do with that.
I have a red jacket.
I noticed that, yes.
I've got red on my tie.
Yeah, and David does too, and I don't know about you, Bill.
Wasn't even thinking.
That's right.
I didn't even know it.
Let's talk about a little bit of history that's occurred here. Jeff Causey was the finance officer prior to Amy Weaver. Jeff left and Amy Weaver was named finance manager and also continued her previous duties. So in other words, she was holding two spots and doing double the work, or more. I'm not sure exactly how that went. But she did excel in both jobs. Amy is a visionary. and as such, I have no doubt that she has prepared that department to handle her retirement. My plea to you is to promote from within. To do otherwise, you will lose internal control. You will lose checks and balances, and this county loses. So I think it's awful that we're going to lose Amy after the first of the year, but times change and we have to move on and we have to be prepared. Whatever your plans are, remember that this department was one short when Jeff Causey left.
I think we were money ahead when he left.
We were money ahead, but we were one short in that department.
Good riddance.
I don't remember that much of it. I wasn't that much involved. I would like to say congratulations for the fund balance. And David, you said something at the last meeting about the audit firm that was changed and that they were with us for 40 years. That's why it was changed. No firm should be in that position for more than 3 or 4 years, consecutive years. That's just common sense. You get too lax in what you're doing, and not to say that that happened or anything went wrong, but to keep things on a better term for this county, it's best to change your firms at least every 3 or 4 years and put it out for bid. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Ann.
Thank you.
Our third and final speaker is Mr. Tony Cox. Mr. Cox has stated he does not know what he's going to talk about this morning.
Well, like I've told you before, sorry about that, Mr. Manning. You know, it's warming to the heart to hear this gentleman get up here and talk about that the community and the people at Ace Speedway could get together and work things out instead of maybe like witch hunts and so forth, you know, where the government gets involved and end up being, you know, things happening the way they sometimes happen. I think that'll help the country and the nation to to go forward in the future, to where we work to bring this nation back to the great nation it was before a lot of crazy things started happening. And you know, I just don't know, but maybe things, well, it's not a maybe, things will always get better. I always look forward to tomorrow, because I always say tomorrow is going to be a better day. It is. Tomorrow's always going to be better. I want to talk about something else today, though. I've heard people asking questions about the sheriff and the sheriff's legal expenses. I've not seen anything about where there's any kind of private donations set up to where people can donate to the sheriff's legal defense fund. Me personally, I support all law enforcement 100% when they do their job and follow the law. Now me, I don't have nowhere near what I used to have, but I'm going to tell you what, on this day, I've got $100, and I challenge all my fellow people in Alamance County, give what you can. May I approach? Absolutely. This is a donation to the sheriff.
Sheriff's out of town, so accepting on his behalf.
Well, that's fine. But I do. I support our sheriff, and I believe that our sheriff knows the difference between breaking the law and not breaking the law. Mr. Britt, thank you. Thank you to the sheriff's department. And I look to move forward. Thank y'all.
Thank you, Tony. Tim, you want to step forward?
We'll take it.
We have a project fund set up for that.
Okay. So who wants this today?
We'll take it.
Amy.
I like that.
Okay. Thank you very much. That concludes the public comment portion of our meeting. This time, we'll ask for any commissioners' responses.
In regard to Ann's comments, you're exactly right on the auditor scenario. We put that out for bid, by the way. And the total cost savings, supposedly, over the 3 years is almost $60,000 between what we would have paid the local people based on the bids that they submitted, and they also gave projected bids on what they thought the second and third year would be, the local people. And what we did was a savings of almost $60,000. And I think a good audit. So that's my personal opinion.
Thank you, Tim. Any other responses at this time? If not, let's review the proposed agenda. Mr. Honeycutt, do you have any changes to the agenda that we have in front of us?
Thank you, Tony. Can I say thank you to Tony? Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm sorry.
That's all right.
Yeah. That's all right. Commissioners,
if you would review the agenda, and if there are any changes, or on the consent agenda, if there's any item that you would like pulled from consent to have full discussion, let's talk about those. Are there any such items? Hearing none, is there a motion to approve the agenda, including the consent agenda items?
So moved.
Thank you, Linda. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Bill. Tim, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The consent agenda is approved along with the full agenda, so we'll now move to item number 6, Department Spotlight presentation today. I'd like to welcome Mr. Hugh Webster, Register of Deeds. Good morning, sir.
Good morning. Thank you. Honorable ladies and gentlemen. I appreciate y'all letting me make this little presentation here. And I would like to, before I start with this, I would like to say that most people tell you that you never hear from anybody, even dealing with the public, unless something's wrong, unless they got a complaint. In my shop, that's not the case. Probably 49 times out of 50, when I hear from the public, it's good things. And this morning, before I came over here, I looked at my email, and there was one boasting about what good service they got from my employees. And I would like to tell you that I've lived and worked on four continents. I've had some excellent help over the years, but I have never had any better group of help, staff, than I've got here in Alamance County. And I'm very proud of them. Now, I will tell you, you have copies of what I'm fixing to go over. I don't read speeches, but I decided to read this one because I didn't want to get to rambling too much. I know most of you know me as Hugh Webster, the North Carolina politician, or perhaps Hugh Webster, the redneck farmer from Caswell County. While I'm proud to wear both of those labels today, I need for you to know more about the Hugh Webster you don't know. The Hugh Webster you don't know has been working with computers and designing computer systems for over four decades. In 1967, while I was in college, I was asked by an economics professor to help her because I was the only student writing programs that would actually run. When I worked in South Africa, I designed a computer system that not only kept track of the billing of multiple subcontractors on a project, but also kept track of where each of the 20,000 personnel were at any given time. Upon seeing this, the government of South Africa wanted to employ me to design a system that would keep track of the residents of the country. I have designed payroll systems for many different clients over the years and could not have accomplished any of these goals without the other Hugh Webster you don't know. That Hugh Webster has been working with numbers for his entire life and as a result has become very money conscious. I never make a decision regarding money without concern for not only the greater good, but for the good of those who work for me. I offer this information to you because I need you to understand that the Alamance County Register of Deeds office is at a crossroads and some financial decisions need to be made in a short period of time. The Register of Deeds office serves as custodian and manager of public land records and vital records and is governed by the general statutes of North Carolina. The Register of Deeds is charged with the integrity, completeness, accuracy, and safekeeping of these records. From the 1800s to the present, these records have been kept largely in paper form. Documents are being recorded at a rate that indicates our office will run out of physical space to store these paper records before the current fiscal year is over. When I prepared our budget this fiscal year, I asked for $2.5 million to build a new facility to house all of these paper records. I consider this to be a heads up for the county manager and county commissioners that some drastic action is needed. Because I am so money conscious, my assistant and I have also been doing research for some time, going back even before that, in order to find another solution for this inevitable problem. We have researched alternative software and have visited several other Register of Deeds offices, finding out what has and has not worked for them. Our conclusion is that we must move away from paper as our form of record storage. This transition will save the county the millions of dollars needed to build a new facility, as well as saving money on the reams and reams of special paper and binders needed to store these records. Transition will also save money on printer wear and tear, as well as tone and postage spent on returning documents after they are recorded. In order for me to save the county from having to spend the millions of dollars so that we can remain in compliance with North Carolina General Statute 161, county management needs to know that I have a vision that, when implemented, will allow us to stay in the space that we now occupy and bring Alamance County Register of Deeds into the 21st century at the same time. To accomplish this, we can't wait for a current employee to retire. Fortunately, there's a position within our office that has remained vacant since May of 2011. A full-time computer person is needed within our office. This person's responsibilities will be multifaceted and will include working with the various departments within our office as we transition to a new system in order to ensure that the person who fills this position can best help our current employees. He or she will have to be cross-trained in all four departments within the Register of Deeds office. Cross-training is necessary to ensure that he or she will help build a system that best fits our needs. The added benefit is that when we find ourselves short-staffed, this person can go to any department and work effectively to help us serve our customers. And a side note to this is that we have the policy in our office of cross-training everybody to do everybody else's job. And so, because we are governed by North Carolina General Statute 161, before this fiscal year is over, the county has a few choices. Spend millions of dollars on a new facility for the Register of Deeds. Allow me to fill the office vacancy that has existed since May 2011. Or take an existing position from MIS and transfer it to the Register of Deeds. And so, it is the computer savvy, money conscious Hugh Webster that stands before you today, asking you to choose to help not only the Register of Deeds, but the taxpayers of Alamance County by allowing me to bring my vision to life. I think that the time is close upon us to do something. Our land record space is might last until the end of the fiscal year or on a little bit past that. We have already bought the binders. We haven't bought all the paper to fill up those binders. But at the rate that we're going, it's just about to the middle of next calendar year, which is the end of the fiscal year. My hope is to transition to electronically stored records completely. Now we have all our land records are on paper form. Almost nobody ever looks at those papers. We have to meet a standard. Now we have three redundancies. One, computer records here in Graham, computer records in Ohio, and computer records in Raleigh. But we have to meet standards in order to give up on those papers. And we need to be able to do it. We have gotten rid of some of the necessity of some of the vital papers. But anyway, if y'all have some questions, I'm available now or later or any time.
Yeah, what would the documents be? Would they be scanned and then archived, and then you could get rid of the hard copies? Is that kind of what you're talking about?
That's part of it.
So if somebody came into your office and didn't want to see an old land record, they would have the ability to go to your computer system and pull it up and look at it and print it if they wanted it.
Yes, in our office, we have computer stations that's available to lawyers, paralegal, the public. You can come in our office, and we have people that will help you help you at one of the terminals. We have people that will actually look it up for you. Now, if you want to do that often, we'd prefer that you learn to do it yourself. But we will help you do it. Now, what is happening is something called e-recording. It comes in, the land records, deeds of trust, comes into Graham, and I say Graham because deeds must first come to the tax office. The tax office must say yay or nay as to whether we can record that deed. This is something that the legislature acted on about 2 years ago, and the county commissioners requested, and the legislature acted on. And now we can't record most deeds. We can't record until the tax office says yes. Okay. So, but with what they call e-recording, electronic recording, it comes in through the air, through the computer. Comes into tax office checks to see if the tax is occurring on it, and then they retransmit it to us, and we record it. What we're doing now is printing it and putting it in the paper books. And we also deposit it in those three digital files, electronic files that I spoke of. Ohio, Graham, Raleigh. Now.
So if, when this is all done, why then could the whole process not be web-based so people could get that information from anywhere?
It is now.
Okay, so they don't have to come into your office. They can go.
That's right.
Okay. And you're getting the information already in digital form, and your step would be to avoid printing it out. Is that right?
That's partially right. We're not getting it, and most of our stuff is not coming in digital form now. But we are transitioning to having more and more of it coming in digital form.
Senator, do the statutes allow you to transition to electronic completely?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but of course, it has to be. You know, you can't transition completely unless the attorneys, unless the users, the banks, the attorneys, insurance companies, send it to us electronically. Of course, we'll be continuing to be able to accept it on paper. But as time goes on, you know, it's a whole lot cheaper for them to send it through the computers than it is for them to drive from Winston-Salem to Grant. It's expensive for them to send runners over here. But it's happening.
But even in that scenario, you could scan what you receive and not worry about the hard copy.
That's exactly right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the other question I have is, in addition to your person, have you shopped for whatever technology needs you may have and kind of put together a project cost for all this?
No. Yes, no.
That's a good answer. I try to give that answer a lot.
We have visited two other registers of deeds, and we're finding, and we've talked with several, and we're seeing what software they're using, and they seem to have one of the things that they have in common is that they have an in-house computer person, somebody that's right there all the time. And that's dedicated to the Register of Deeds. Not meaning to take anything away from Frank. There's Frank. Frank, you're so little, I can't hardly see you.
I'm just wasting away.
But we look at who is using what software. And this year, we use a company called COTS in Ohio. And they wanted a 3-year renewal on the contract, and they wanted to go up on the fees. I said, you're crazy as hell. My staff hasn't had a raise in 5 years. And you want a 15% raise? No way. Absolutely no way. They wound up getting a 1-year contract and a 5% raise. That's enough of that. I don't need to say any more about that.
And have you gone over kind of these plans with Craig and Brian and kind of come up with a game plan and time frame?
Mm-mm. No.
Well, that's what I would suggest. I mean, I agree with the need. I mean,
every chance I get, and somebody from my office, usually it's the assistant register of deed, and a couple of weeks ago, last week, I don't know when it was, four of us, somebody from Vital, somebody that's been working in Vital, somebody has been working, Vitals is births, deaths, marriages, land records is, well, recording is mainly land records. It's also where they record odds and ends stuff and you know, the famous recording of the same-sex marriage up in Buncombe County. And it's also where the people that some people call, what do they call them, Tim? Sovereign citizens. Come in and record trashy stuff about usually some highway patrolman or some judge that they don't like, or some deputy they don't like. And somebody wanted us to refuse to record something from some of these people that they think is outlaws, and I said, now, none of us in here have any guns or any flak jackets or anything, and you won't, and y'all got all kinds of people with guns around you down there in the courthouse, and you can squat down behind that thing. It's got a 3/4-inch steel plate in it, and you want me to tell my people to refuse something? Uh-uh. What I'm going to tell them is, take the money and smile and record it. Now, you can look on your computer to see if anything's recorded against you. But I ain't going to endanger my people. Because even I don't have a gun in here. So.
Other questions or comments for him this time?
I think it's obvious we're going to have to do something. I went in for Christmas dinner, freebie that you had over there, and I've been going in there for years. It's an archaic situation, to be honest about it. Not what you're doing, but the building, the facility. We got to do something more modern, in my opinion.
I thought it was a nice building.
it needs some work.
We don't have to get strip searched to go in to work like we do over here. They made me go through all this. I got something to tell y'all. The purpose of terrorism is to terrorize. If they scare the hell out of y'all, they won. They didn't scare me.
Nope.
Thank you, Hugh. Next on the agenda is a resolution in support of the vision for public education in Alamance County. Each of you should have a summary statement of the vision statement that was placed at your setting this morning. The little bit of background on this, a little bit over a year ago, there was a group of people from the community put together, primarily not educators, but including some students, some parents, community members, members from law enforcement, to discuss a long-term vision for public education in Alamance County. And the result of that process that lasted about 10 months was a complete document of which you have, I think, the summary, talking about the future vision for public education. And this is available if anybody would like to review this as well. The stakeholder group was headed up by two individuals from the community, Derek Steed and also Dale Page. And they had a group of, oh gosh, there was probably 60 people plus that spent a number of months looking at all different areas of where we'd like to see public education go. And the result of their work is this vision. And they are now asking local governments and other groups to support a resolution to support that vision. This vision is to be delivered and has been delivered to the school board to be used as a basis for the development of a strategic plan. And I would like to read, this is not long, I'd like to read this resolution and see if we can have a motion to support it for the Alamance County Public School System. Resolution in support of the vision for public education in Alamance County. Whereas the Alamance County Board of Commissioners believes that education is the foundation for individual success, economic prosperity, improved quality of life in our democratic society, And whereas the Alamance County Board of Commissioners believes strongly in our community and the need for strengthening the foundations for the success of Alamance County, whereas we believe that educating Alamance County children will prepare good citizens, a talented workforce, and strong leaders, and that improving our public education can improve the quality of life for our citizens, whereas there exists a vision for public education in Alamance County approved by the Alamance County Board of Education on May 24th, 2013, I'm not sure that date's right, that envisions, among other things, oh, May 24th is when it was completed, I'm sorry, that's when they completed their work. Among other things, a public school system that is a national model for its curriculum and community engagement to empower all Alamance County students with equal opportunity for civic engagement, a meaningful quality of life, and skills for economic success for themselves and for our community. Whereas the Alamance County Board of Commissioners recognizes that public schools need community support to be successful, now therefore the Alamance County Board of Commissioners hereby publicly approves the vision for public education in Alamance County and further declares its support and commitment to achieving the vision for the future of Alamance County. So I submit that to the board and would ask for a motion.
So moved.
Thank you, Tim. Is there a second? Linda, any discussion or questions about this resolution or the document?
I'd like to say something about the theory on public education. You know, there's a lot of criticism out there. That's because we're in a free society and we're not robots and we have our opinions. And God help us, I hope we'll always be able to do that in this country. I don't know about y'all, but public education, my high school, best days of my life. College, average. But my high school, little dinky town in South Carolina, produced some good people. And not that I was one of them, but the debate needs to always continue as to what's right, what's wrong, what's excessive, what's right, what's left. That's what makes this country great. And public education, with all its criticism, it needs to have input from everybody without prejudice. And we all need to be a part of making it better rather than worse. And again, they were the best days of my life. I support public education. Don't agree with everything they do and don't agree with all the board's decisions. Boards, not necessarily this board, but other boards. And necessarily, and principals and teachers and so on. But it's ours to lose or ours to make better. And I choose to try to make it better.
Thank you, Tim. Other comments before we call for the question? We have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. Our chairman of the school board is with us this morning, Mr. Tony Rose. Tony, I'd like to sign this and have you take a copy with you this morning, if you would come forward. And we wish you luck, and also from the school board is Pam Thompson. Pam, welcome to you. We'd like for you to take this with our blessing to the board and wish you the best of luck in your strategic planning session.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Tim, thank you for your comments.
Well, I meant every word of them.
And speaking of schools, we are fortunate today to be able to consider the release and blessing of some lottery money that is scheduled to be used for some school projects. And rather than go into a lot of background on the lottery, I'll ask the folks from the schools who are here to make that presentation. Johnny Rogers, good morning.
Good morning
to you.
Chairman and fellow.
Welcome.
This is a pleasure to be here. At present time, we've held back for a couple of years on requesting bond and lottery funds. We hit the first session strong and hard and got a lot accomplished. But like everything else, there comes a time when additional funds are needed to continue on the work we have been doing at that time. We've listed the bond projects that we've got coming up within the next year. And primarily it's a continuation of what we had. Roof coatings, modular roofs, replacing the existing roofs with metal roofs. We're doing key lock work since security has become such an issue, we're having to update several of our front entrances to accommodate the security systems that they're putting in at the present time. Paving, just a few minor projects on that. As far as plumbing goes, we have some old existing, and I'm sure some of you are familiar with the old tight floor urinal systems where, you know, that's not necessarily a health or a positive situation. We've got two or three little projects to clean up on that. Cummings High tennis court, we've put it in to try to bring it back online with the what's required by the Recreation Association. Lottery funds, that's a continuing application. We still have a process of removing asbestos project at Williams High School. That's been done in segments. It's such a large, extensive project that you can only do certain areas within a 3-month period of time during the summer. The carpet removal and VCT replacement, we've got three sites, Elon, Woodlawn, and Alpha Ospe. And the problem with the carpets, like everywhere else, is either worn, frayed, or buckling up, and there's no way to keep taking all the trip hazards out of it except to replace it. Painting-wise, we'll do the same three schools as we did the last run. We did five schools the last time. We removed carpet, put PCT in, and painted it the same process. It worked out clean, convenient, and we were able to make a clean sweep and walk away from those schools. So these same three schools will be in the process to be painted. We're replacing Graham High School's gym floor. It's pretty well basically atrocious. It's getting to be, we're having to spend more on repairs than it's worthwhile to maintain, and it's easier and in the long run far more functional to replace the floor. Stage floors in the system, my crew has done all they can do to patch and repair. Outside contractors done it. We've come up with some new designs for stage flooring, which should tremendously aid in production without splinters, nail pops, and all of this taking place. That's in the lottery fund also. And basically, that covers the applications we're looking to address within the next year. If anyone has any questions concerning any of these projects, feel free to ask.
Go ahead, Tim. Are all the, I've stepped out and I apologize, are all the requests within the parameters of lottery approval?
Yes, sir.
That's what I was going to mention. There's a sheet on our agenda that shows the lottery history. It's a great summary, but it is very brief. But basically, since inception, the county school system has received over $13 million in lottery funds. They spent over $10 million. Current balance is about $3 million. And the estimate that the state provides for lottery allocation to county, the counties for the current fiscal year, Alamance County is supposed to get about $1.5 million. So this would certainly fall under that, and you conceivably could come back for additional projects if you saw the need.
The need is there, but it didn't press my situation at this point in time. Down the road, there will be some HVAC issues that will have to be addressed just because of age and energy cost calculations. I've got some chiller units that have been online for almost 30 years. Good Lord blessed us. By the way, while I'm up here, I would like to say I definitely appreciated the additional $250,000 that y'all granted this year for maintenance. Needless to say, most all of that's been spent and taken care of. I got a little pocket change of it left, but I've got three other places that I'm getting prices on to spend that money. So nothing is from my end of the educational business, my part's functional. And the functional part is to maintain buildings, keep everything safe, and try to look 5 years beyond. There's no looking at today. You need to be looking 5 years down the road, and that's basically our policy of maintenance, and that's what we strive to do. And hopefully we've accomplished a rather considerable amount in that process.
Let me say something to the commissioners of the school board that's here. The only thing the county is responsible for is maintenance of the building. All this other bullshit that you're spending money on, this is what needs to be done. the repairs of the building. This is important.
And we also have benefited for some major classroom expansions over the years. I know, what, Western Middle and
Alamo ISP.
AO.
And,
you know, further back.
Several school projects.
You ever Wilson?
Sylvan.
Jordan, I think, got some.
Right, Jordan did. Wilson did. Sylvan did. We've expanded classrooms, you know, and like I said, knock on wood, we've always been very fortunate that we could come in under budget or not to exceed the budget. So that's, I think the school maintenance people have developed a good track record.
Well, and John, you certainly have provided that leadership for a long time as well.
So thank you, sir.
Is there a motion to...
I'd like to ask a couple of questions.
Sure.
Before we
yes,
do.
Sir.
And you had the right figure, or the figure that I had here, 13 overall, balance of three. We spent 10 since 2006-07 through 2013-14. How many classrooms have we added?
It's average four classrooms per site. I know we added during the whole bond process.
Well, through
the last run
through the with lottery money. You've had pods at some of the high schools,
right?
Like what, four classrooms per
As
pod?
As a rule of thumb, it's been four
yeah.
classrooms.
What I want to know is, of the 10 million, how many classrooms did we get out of that technically?
That's an on-the-spot question. My memory served me pretty well, but offhand, 12 to 18, somewhere
yeah,
in that range.
Between 12 and 18. That's, I'd have to go back and look at the
I'd
numbers.
Like to know that figure, if you okay. would.
I'll get that information for you.
And the schools at where they were put, if you don't mind.
We've got them itemized, and we can get that to you.
Yeah, because I've seen the ones in Andrews and been through them, and they are nice.
We did something in Hall River, didn't we?
Yes. Yep. They had the classroom.
We've done Sylvan, Feed, Jordan. River.
Yeah, it may be higher than your figure, John.
Trying to pinpoint specific bond, like Highland Elementary School, that was
the bond issue.
That was a bond project.
Right.
And so there's some, after a while you do so many, it sort of runs together, and we keep analogous. I'm like a gentleman said in a movie, Sean Connery said, son, I didn't commit it to memory because I wrote it in my notebook. And that's basically what we do. We keep a running tally of everything we've done over the last several years.
You also did Western High School, didn't you?
Western Middle.
A full classroom.
High,
yeah.
But that was that
in
was
Eastern High
bond.
School. We did
was that bond
addition.
Money.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That was bond, and we did an addition at Eastern High School. I had that bond also.
I've got two other, and if y'all could get those figures, numbers of classrooms, where they're at, pods, I'd like to see all that.
Okay.
Two issues, though, with me I got to ask you about. The crack in the floor, second floor, what's the status of that?
As it turns out, that was Jay and WD handled that project. Jay's had the engineer come on site. According to the engineer's criteria, it's not a structural application, it's just a stress crack. We have a company now that we're dealing with that has a product on the market that I'm addressing, sidewalks, concrete canopy walkways where the concrete breaks loose or cracks up or does a rise or fall issue on you. And they're coming to town next week. I believe it's the week of the 21st of this month. And we're going to have them address the issue at the tech center also. Take a look, see what kind of agent that they have that we can place in that crack to tie the bond in and recut it.
Can you tell how deep it is across the hall?
Jay, did y'all remember?
No, it's the concrete up there is 4 inches thick, so it's cracked probably all the way through.
Okay. Mm-hmm. But according to the engineer, he didn't consider it to be a structural issue, of course.
It's all the way through, it's structural.
Well, that would be my thoughts also. But anyhow, the firm that we're dealing with now has products that will bond, and that's what I'm after because I've got a couple of concrete walkways where the concrete's chiseling off from 30 years of abuse and moisture and Mother Nature. And this product will go back in here and be structurally sound, and that's what we're testing out now.
Now, is there a warranty on that
yes,
scenario?
Sir. They're supposed to provide a warranty for the product, and that's what we're investigating. We've checked a lot of products on the market in the last year or two. And sometimes you got to weed your way through to find out what is proven to be. And like anything else, history and time prove out your product. But this company's been in business for probably over 40 years, and this has always been their strong suit, so that's the reason we called them into the picture.
And in my last, it may sound like I've belabored it, it may sound like I'm being picky, but I think it's symbolic of something that I'm concerned about, even if it's at a low level. And Dr. Monroe and I have talked about this, but I'd just like to get the status of that mobile classroom at South Graham on the second row that looks like it's down a dirt road in West Virginia.
Well,
what have we done about that?
Primarily, the guys went out and checked the unit. And the biggest problem I'm having, bar none, Mother Nature kicked me a royal this past summer. We got the paint sprayer, I've got the paint, I've got all that to push it. But I couldn't get enough dry weather to actually make a run at anything. The roofs are being replaced. Even now, I've already replaced some of the modular unit roofs that I was having issues with. So we haven't sat on our hands. It's just a matter of getting a good run to do it. And weather is probably more critical for my purposes than any other issues. And like I said, I've never seen a summer like we had this past summer. We had everything lined up and ready to hit the road running. And first thing out the gate was a roadblock. So South Graham's units, the guys have been down making repairs of any issues that they've had. And we are dependent on the school sites to turn in work orders requesting whatever problems they may be having. But also my crews generate as many work orders in the process of going on the site working. They will notice things that the average layperson would not. So it's hand in hand, but it's not a dead issue. Nothing dies in our neighborhood.
Yeah. And I'm not being critical of you. I've never talked to you about this before.
Right.
No offense. I would be embarrassed to drive somebody from out of town with me to drive up in that driveway and see that unit sticking out. And I've been told you can't paint them. I mean, you can paint a mailbox.
This is the aluminum unit.
Right, exactly.
Oh, that's a jewel, yes, sir.
You know which one I'm talking about?
It's the old style modular units that came out with the aluminum roof siding and all of that. And it's hard to make. As the old saying goes, you can paint the barn red, but you're not gonna make the barn any better. But
it's aesthetic, no question about it. But I've been over there for over 12 months asking questions about that unit. And to me, it's just symbolic of, you got one problem like that, you're going to, it multiplies on out. So I hope, and I went around and looked at the back door of the classroom coming out the back. I mean, it was a tetanus shot hazard. I mean, it was just terrible.
Well, see, and one of the issues that I have, Mr. Sutton, is the fact that if my guys see it, someone should have written a work order up on it. But if it's something that I haven't gotten a work order in, then I'll follow up and find out why I haven't got some paperwork. Because as a rule of thumb, like I said, I've got grand total of 50 people doing everything. I've got 4 electricians, I got 5-6 carpenters and 4 plumbers and this type. But I depend on everyone has to work together as a team to make it accomplished. And I'll go look at that door.
Please do. Lord knows I've asked about it.
Now, don't get your feelings hurt when I screw a sheet of weatherproof plywood over it, since I'm only required to have one door out of that unit. But we'll take care of that part.
All right.
Okay.
John, we need to have a formal vote to approve these proceeds. If you'll hang with us for a second. Is there a motion to, we actually have 4 different sets of requests outlined, as Johnny did, the replacing of carpet, painting, asbestos removal, a new gym floor for Graham High School, to replace the stage floor. There's a motion. Thank you, Bill. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Tim. Any other discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. Thank you, John.
It's been a pleasure.
Appreciate
Thank you.
Your time.
I appreciate it.
Now we are pleased to have a website presentation by Scott Ward, our county webmaster. Scott, good morning.
Good morning. Good morning, commissioners.
Good morning.
PowerPoint, please.
Somebody needs to get the light.
Mm-hmm. I think it'll be that one. There we go.
Can we get part of the lights there?
Thank you, brother. Commissioners, this morning I am pleased to present the new county website. We've been working on this project for a while, and we launched last week, and here to present it to you. This morning I'm going to give you a brief history of how we got here. Some of the reasons that we've made this change, I'm going to talk about some of the new features that we have. We're going to take you to the new website and let you look around. Taking you back in time, back in 1999, we launched our first website, and it was pretty terrible. The redesign, this is actually the redesign of that site. The first major redesign occurred in March of 2000, added things like better navigation, but it was still a very hands-on process. People had to specifically go in and code everything that was going on. But it was a very popular design. The library stuck with it until 2009. In 2004, on December 20th, we launched this next iteration of the county website. Featured better navigation, a cleaner interface, more information. Behind the scenes, there were, and that's one of the things that you don't normally see when you go to a website, is a lot of the work that goes behind the scenes. Behind the scenes, we had a lot more departments involved in getting information out. There we go. And it was also more stable. It had better management tools for me to do what I needed to do. In 2009, on April 1st, we launched the just recent county website. Had a professionally designed layout. All county departments now had a website. And behind the scenes, the management tools got even better. Of course, as time goes on, technology goes on. We also reduced costs going from the earlier website to this website, which was a big advantage. The new county website launched, the date up there is a little bit incorrect. It actually launched the 30th at 10 p.m. at night. So the reasoning we did this, number one, like I said, technology changes over time. You know, you guys are now using iPads, which just even 5 years ago weren't even anywhere on the radar. Things that used to be complex and expensive are now simpler, and they're usually a little bit less expensive. The other big factor is the way that the users use the web changes. So used to be you had your Netscape Navigator and your AOL dial-up, and it would take you, you know, 10 minutes to load a really good web page. And well, now people have high-speed internet. I don't think anybody uses Netscape Navigator anymore. Also, our needs as an organization shift. The way we need to run our website shifts. An old school, but a good rule of thumb is that a good redesign happens every 3.5 to 5 years. We've been averaging about 4.5 years between redesigns. Our new website features some good features that I'd like to share with you. Like I said, this was a 2-year design process that we really actually put together in 2 months. We planned for 2 years and then pushed it through very, very quickly. Excuse me, I had a week up there. It has a much, much cleaner design. It appeals to more people. It's similar to Apple or Google or Microsoft, where it's just basic information. You don't have a lot of flashy graphics, and it's just very basic, but it's clean and it's functional for what people need to use it for. Has more built-in features to get information where it needs to go. There is a potential for reduced costs. Obviously, I know you guys as commissioners are concerned about how the money gets spent. At this point, I don't have any hard numbers. I am anticipating that we'll be able to save hopefully 20% on our current costs. There's better continuity of operation. One of the big concerns I've had as webmaster is if we have a major disaster and people need to get web information, how are they going to get it if this building doesn't have power? Well, this new website helps to take care of that. And of course, you know, the thought is, well, who's going to plug in their computer, turn on their computer, log in, get on the internet, and do all this to get disaster information? Well, nowadays, the web has changed, and people have changed, and they're not getting their information necessarily even off of TV anymore when they've got cell phones that are hooked up to the internet all the time. Which actually leads us to the next point, which is a mobile-friendly design. This is very, very important for the modern web. I forget whether I do talk about this right here. The web has changed significantly over the past few years. Mobile users represent a very, very quickly growing part of our viewership on the website. Like I said, you no longer need to have a computer that's plugged up to the wall. You guys are using iPads that connect to the internet. I've got a phone right here that connects to the internet. A few weeks ago, Frank talked about the number of mobile users, and I'm sorry to kind of spring this on you, but even now, those numbers are out of date. I did a check just before we launched our new website. In March 2012, 9% of our users or so were mobile. In October, that shot up to 12 2/3%. Last month, over 20% of our users coming to our website were using phones. So this is a very important group that we wanted to focus on when we did our redesign. So we're going to visit our new site. Kenny, if you'll alt-tab over to the new county website there. Here we go. Like I said, our design is a lot cleaner. There's a lot of white space up there. This little thing up here that you're seeing has it lets us change images. So if we want to promote a couple of things going on in the county, we can do so. The commissioner's video. Kenny, if you'll scroll that page down just a little bit. Down at the bottom, you'll see we have this little section down here. And Kenny, if you'll click on commissioner video and meeting information, we've got it right there. There's the old information. There's the video from the last meeting available right on our website. We've got county news. Kenny, if you'll go over to county government and go to county commissioners. There we go. I always like showing off your page to you guys. Tori's done a very good job of this, I think.
Lord, that's a shady looking group.
We all look mad.
So we have pages for the county commissioners. Kenny, if you'll go over to where it says county commissioners, you'll see that we have our commissioners. And hover over that, please. There we go. And you'll see you each have your own individual page there. We've got information about meetings that has all the agendas and minutes from the PET. All the agendas since 2008, and I believe all of the minutes since 2000. So there's a lot of information out there. Page for the clerk to the board. Information about public notices and ordinances. So there's a lot of good information just on your site. Now, Kenny, if you'll return to the county homepage and then go to, if you'll scroll back up and go to departments, health, public, human and public services, and environmental health. I have to brag on Carl Carroll. I wish he was here because his site is fantastic. He has got so much information buried in these little headings up here that has information about well drillers, restaurant inspections, hotel inspections, pool inspections, home inspections, just all sorts of really good information buried in this site. And it's all very, very easy to find for the users. I'm really pleased with what he and his folks have done. Brian's folks over in Recreation have done a bang up job again. They're just kind of our star websites. We also did do a redesign of the library site. Kenny, if you'll go to www.alamancelibraries.org. And their site is a very similar layout, a little bit different background because they've had a different identity over the years, but very similar layout, similar features. Martha Sink over there works on that website, and they do a fantastic job. I'm really pleased with it. Kenny, if you'll go back to the PowerPoint, please. The resume slideshow. There we go. All right. So in conclusion, we are very proud of this website. I'm very proud of the people that worked on it. We're excited about what it's going to do to draw in businesses and visitors and what it's going to do for our current citizens and employees. Our employees, like I said, have done a fantastic job. They literally had about two weeks to get their work done. I worked on it for about 2 months. They had about 2 weeks to move 27, 28 departments over from our old website to our new one. And this is in conjunction with their existing job duties. So they did a great job, and I'm very grateful to them. Grateful to our website committee. I've had a lot of compliments from the public about the design and about the layout. People seem to really like what we've done. They really like the vision that this gives people for Alamance County, so we're just very excited. And at this point, I will be happy to take any questions that you have.
Scott, do you know when people go to the site, is there a way to determine what they're really looking for, or are they just surfing?
We can't really tell what they're looking for, but we can see the pages that they're going to. In Frank's presentation, I think he listed out the top pages, and typically it's going to be libraries, GIS information, register of deeds, tax information, the sheriff's department, and social services. Those are going to be our big ones, and human resources. Almost forgot Sherry over here.
Well, it's very impressive.
Thank you, sir.
Any comments or questions from commissioners?
I have one. I made a mess on my iPad this past week, and I don't know what I did. But anyway, Tammy Rowland has been really great to get me out of my dilemma.
She left something up for you.
I got it.
Well, I'll be sure to tell her that you thanked her publicly in front of the whole world.
Oh, that's great. She's a smart girl.
Well, and
I know all of you are smart too. And Frank, I love Frank too. He's just real congenial.
Well, I've been with the county now for 16 years, mm-hmm. over 16 years, almost 17 years. Wow! And I tell you, I have never worked with a better group of people than I do up on the third floor. There's some really good people up there.
Well, I just want to thank y'all for all you do.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks, Scott.
Yes, sir.
Appreciate
thank
your
you.
Time and all your work. Okay, at this time we'll hear from the county manager. Do you have a report for us, Craig?
I do. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I do want to also thank Scott and MIS and all of our departments for the work that went into the website, and we do appreciate the opportunity to show it to you. And also, as we try to be more transparency in what we do, we think this will make it much easier. So again, thanks to Scott and all the people that worked on this. In front of you, as we discussed at the last meeting, is a proposed ad for the finance officer's position. And we also put a list of the employees and their job duties. We also gave you a new job description for the finance officer position. And if the board is okay, we're ready to go ahead and advertise. But since this position reported to you, want to make sure you are okay with the job description and making sure you are okay with the ad.
Have you combined two jobs, finance officer and finance manager?
Right now it's just finance officer.
This says finance director. What is the finance director?
Kind of the finance officer position over, not including the finance manager position, but this will be the separate. And just, you know, looking at a finance director's position who would be over finance, but not the manager's part.
I don't understand. By statute, I think the title is what? Finance officer, isn't it?
Well, right now, Mr. Smith, it's like finance officer slash manager.
Yeah, you hold both positions.
Right, and I think what Craig was doing, he was trying to separate, like just have the finance director and then the finance manager, but separate those two duties. Because the finance manager position is actually doing some journal entry stuff like that really probably don't need to be doing. So I think that's what Craig was doing, trying to separate those.
We were hopefully, and again, Amy has done a wonderful job, but she's done a lot of the data entry and clerk type position, and we really do need to separate those two responsibilities and really make it a position that doesn't have to do data entry.
So you're going to separate what Amy's doing now, is that what you're doing?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
How many people do we have per category? Like, do we have two finance techs? If you have two categories.
We've got four, I think.
Yeah, they're all listed.
Four right. Finance techs.
Are the people, I mean, I see the generic title and their duties, but are the names in here?
No, the names are not in there.
Or
I'll get
the
you
people?
The names. I can get you the names. That's just the positions.
All right. Well, can you go to page, I guess it's under Alamance County Finance Department jobs, main functions, and you come down and you have a column size finance tech, Then you go over finance tech, finance specialist, assistant finance manager, and finance manager. Now, can we just go back to that first sheet and tell me how many people you got per category or group?
You mean like finance tech?
You got finance tech, you know.
There's, okay, we got four finance techs.
Okay, all right.
Two of them work with accounts payable and purchase orders. And then we have one finance tech. She handles all the revenue for the county, deposits, receipts, and then we have...
Hold on. Sorry. Now, is that one that you just listed, one, is that inclusive in the four, or is that separate?
No, that's one of the four.
One of the four.
Mm-hmm. And then the fourth finance tech, she handles all of our reconciliation of bank statements, enters our receipts, the balance and distributes bookkeeping. She just does a lot of miscellaneous job things for finance.
So four finance techs.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Finance specialist.
Our finance specialist, she handles all the payroll for the county.
Is that separate from the four?
That's right. And she handles all the county insurance and vehicle titles, prepares all the quarterly reports, the W-2s. So she mainly works with the payroll part of it. Okay, and then we have the assistant finance manager.
And that's separate from the four.
And that's separate. Yes, sir.
And that, what was that title again?
The assistant finance manager. She helps with the budget and the audit, handles all of our federal and state reporting, just a lot of miscellaneous.
Contracts. And then,
I'm sorry.
And contracts, too.
Contracts, handles all the county contracts. Then the finance manager, that's part of the duties that I'm still doing, which is what we're talking about, probably needs to be split out because I'm doing those duties and then also... some finance officer duties.
So you're actually suggesting adding to those numbers, right?
Not really at this time, just separating some of the duties out.
Okay. All right, and then her position.
Yes, sir.
So is the total seven or eight, Amy?
It would still be the same.
Which is what?
Seven or eight.
Seven.
Okay, so the purchasing manager is
purchasing. Yes, sir. I just consider that separate. There's two in the purchasing department. It does fall under finance, but they have really nothing to do with the finance duties. It's all separate, and they're not. They're actually downstairs. I mean, they're not even, you know, in our department.
So in this list, you would consider your position to be described in the finance manager section. Is that right?
The finance manager section and also some finance officer duties, which Craig's got a new job description for the finance officer.
3, 4, 5. Okay, so there's 7 people, including you, and not including the purchasing people. Right?
That's correct.
Okay.
And that's what we're not requesting any new positions. We're requesting still 7, but just that the finance manager duties be taken off of the finance officer. Because really, the finance officer needs to focus more on, they need to help the county manager more and more reporting as far as to the board on financial statements and things like that. They really shouldn't be doing the finance manager duties. So that's just kind of separating those duties, but not asking for any more staff.
So the county will be advertising just for a finance officer?
Yes, sir.
And the duties of the finance manager, the county manager will assign that to someone else.
Well, if you basically look at our assistant finance manager now, she's doing a lot of those duties now. So there'll be a shifting of, she'll lose some duties and other people will pick up. She'll gain some additional duties. So it'll be a shifting round of duties once we get the position filled.
really, Mr. Smith is probably going to be doing away with, like right now we've got an assistant finance manager, and it's probably going to do away with that position. We would just have a finance manager and then the four techs and the payroll specialist. Right. So we would kind of lose that assistant position.
Right.
You okay with that, Dave?
Yeah.
Where are you going to list the ad? Is that on here somewhere?
There's all the finance officers have a listserv that we would put the ad on that's across the state, and we'd also put it in the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners website and in their publications.
And on Scott's new website.
And on Scott's new website as well.
Okay. Do you have a time frame for listing and application date close?
We would like to close by the end of the month and then start review, you know, have the board start reviewing the applications in December.
Now, I thought we were going to have a little work session about any other ideas or concepts.
We can do that at
well, I thought that was, yeah, I thought that's what, yeah, we said we were going to do.
It's up to the commissioners, Tim.
No. I know the conversation we had. I'm sorry.
Okay. Yeah. Well,
but we can't.
Man, that's up to the commissioners.
Yeah, and Mr. Sutton has some ideas about how to maybe do some things a little bit differently, and you know, that does need to be set as a workshop with the board to see what direction you do want to go in.
Okay, well, why don't we, on that subject, then ask Tori to work on calendars and set up the time, and let's get that done sooner rather than later. Is that all right, everybody?
Yeah, I mean, it's like beating a dead horse. If you got ideas that might work, you know, to, and you know, it doesn't work, fine, but you know, I think you got to be careful where you put the horse in the cart.
We can work on that. Okay.
Morning's work for the board.
Well, let's let Tori work all that out. Any other comments about the finance position at this time? What's the North Carolina statute called the position? I didn't know.
Finance officer.
Okay. That's what I have.
Because Amy's been finance officer and finance manager since 2005, I think.
Yes, sir.
Any other questions or comments about that subject?
If the board's okay, that's what we will go with, and we'll look at the time frame of going ahead and advertising now and having applications back by the end of the month. And then we'll also try to set up this workshop with the board to discuss options, if that's agreeable.
Definitely. Any opposition to that?
No.
Okay.
I hope not.
And Craig, what else you have for us?
That's all we got.
Any other commissioner comments before we adjourn? Any other comments?
Oh, they're betting on the football game down here.
All right, well, there are no other comments. We'll stand adjourned. Thank you all. Thank you all for being here this morning.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.